Hi, good evening. Thank you all for coming and being patient with us and for spending this wonderful occasion with us, because it's really special when we have somebody, we've had speakers here from all over the world, but it's really special when we have somebody right from Pune sharing their work with us. So it's really wonderful that somebody from our community, a book written, researched, printed and published from Pune. Uday, of course, has spoken here before, and it's really wonderful to have him here once again. I'm going to quickly introduce him and the book, and then we'll start. Uday Kulkarni is an alumnus of the Armed Forces Medical College at Pune, and did his post-graduation in surgery from Mumbai University. He served in the Indian Army. Indian Navy. After his retirement, he obtained a degree in communication and journalism from Pune University. He continues to practice surgery in Pune, where he resides with his family. In the last decade, Dr. Kulkarni has authored Solstice at Panipat, 14th January 1761, an authentic account of the Panipat campaign and the era of Bajirao, and edited and translated the Bakhar of Panipat with the late historian Ninad Bedekar. His book Solstice at Panipat has been translated into Marathi and won an award from the Maharashtra
Granthotejak Sabha.
He has contributed to several publications online as well as in print. His new book on James Wales, a Scot who lived in Western India for 4 years, promises to take the reader on a voyage into late 18th century India through his eyes. Further books on 18th century India are planned and will be published in the coming years. We of course look forward to that. Very quickly, James Wales came to India in the last decade of the 18th century as an artist and developed a passion for the antiques of India. His stay in this late medieval period was marked by painting for the nobility of the day and exploration of ancient caves of the country, of which he left copious records and pictures. He jotted down his observations of the nobility, life in the cities and villages, and memoranda of travel in India, horrid social customs, temples and their deities, festivals and forms of entertainment. Together with his illustrations, they are a rich source of that era. It was not long after that India came under British rule and changed forever. This book, which is based on James Wales's journals and pictures, allows us to enter into this bygone era and witness late 18th century India through the eyes of an observant artist and antiquarian. James Wales lived the last 4 years of his life in India and died after a short illness in 1795. He was not destined to publish his work. 200 years later, it has finally seen the light of day. Uday, thanks so much for doing this and for coming.
The mic on? Okay, fine. It's wonderful to be back. This is the 146th, am I right? Incarnation of the Loft Forums programs. And this is my second. So I've just inched above the 1% mark, which is not bad. And of course, the ambience of the Loft is always a pleasure to be back in. And it takes you back probably 5 or 6 decades. But today I'm probably going to take you back much more than that, more than say two centuries or more. And we are probably going to discuss what Western India was at that time and see it in his pictures and what he wrote in his journals and so on. And we'll go back and forth, and sometime somewhere in the middle I'll tell you how I came across all these things. Now it's odd that a Scot artist did more to ensure that Pune and its rulers are remembered and the antiquities of Maharashtra, customs and traditions, villages, deities, temples are recorded and documented through his journals than what, through nearly 300 pictures, than what many other people of that time did. And let us put it another way, that this was available somewhere, but for so many years it was never found and brought out into the open. And in a way, therefore, this book is a kind of a primary source of the times in the late 18th century as they existed here. And the book was also a very long time in making. It tells the story of this man, James Wales, who was born in somewhere near Aberdeen in Scotland, and in 1747 or so, and he came here in 1791, spent 4 years in this country, and finally died here. So the last 4 years of his country were of his stay here were marked by tremendous work, observations, documentation, and it seemed as if he was racing against time to complete a job. And eventually he had big ambitions about publishing it, and if they had been published, there would have been a real record of that India of those days. Along with him, he also brought an assistant from England named Robert Mebon. Now Robert Mebon was a reluctant soldier, he was also a gambler. We have a letter from Robert Mebon written to a British author saying that please get me out of the army, and my ship is going to leave on this so and so date, and I don't want to join the army. I'm sorry for all my misdemeanors, I have been gambling, I have been drinking and all these things, so, but please let me out of this. Samudra, he couldn't get out of it when he was in England. He came to Bombay, and in Bombay he happened to meet none other than James Wales. And though he was a gambler and a drinker and a reluctant soldier, he was an excellent draftsman. And this quality was recognized by Wales when he recruited him in his team. And he remained with Wales for the 4 years that Wales worked here and did many of his initial sketches. And those initial sketches were later developed into finished paintings. How did Wales hear about India? Now, there was a man called James Forbes who had come. He was a chaplain in the East India Company. And when he came to those days in Bombay, he went to the Elephanta Caves and he went to the caves of the Salsette Islands and so on. And he took back sketches from here, principally of Elephanta and of a large banyan tree which he found in India at that time, because he was also in Gujarat for a long time. In fact, there are beautiful diaries of James Forbes written when Raghunath Rao had gone over to the English, on the English side, and James Forbes was his constant attendant at that time. So he was also in Gujarat and he found a big banyan tree which was very famous near Ahmedabad. So he took sketches of these which back to England, and he asked James Wales to complete these into finished drawings. So that is how James Wales was introduced to India through these drawings which James Forbes took back with him. And he also realized that this was a country at that stage where he could earn his fame and his fortune. And that kind of set the ball rolling, and he finally decided that he wanted to come here. To the next slide. Oh, I've got to change here once. Great. So that's why the blurb says enter the world of late 18th century India, and along with James Wales. And the book, which is based on this entire journals and pictures of this man, have been kind of put together in this book where the pictures have been used which go with the text. There are about 300 pages of text in his journals which are there, and most of these have been they are all handwritten manuscripts which were transformed into Microsoft Word documents, then summarized and put on. And it's not just a text, it's a gloriously richly colored illustrated document. It's anything but monotonous monochrome. And that is why it becomes very interesting. It kind of, some of the pictures in fact appear to be even better than today's photographs, because they bring out some kind of a inner vitality in the subjects that he draws, which you will not probably see in today's photographs. So, and you'll, as I go along, you'll find out how we compose these pictures. So, in addition to seeing pictures, he was such a meticulous and observant person that, for example, when he went to Ellora, where he spent 6 weeks, he kept a note, he made a note of what are the things which he is to observe, and he wrote on top of the note that this is to be kept in my pocket at all times. So when he went into a cave, he used to open that paper and see what are the things he needs to note down in that particular cave. So extremely meticulous in what all he did. Unfortunately, he left behind a lot of work which remained unfinished, and today he had a lot of ambitions, he could not complete it, and hopefully today we will see how he completed those drawings and how they were finally brought, they are being brought before the world. Now the first place he reached was Bombay. Now which was in a way unusual, because most of the British artists who came to India at that time, they made a beeline for Calcutta, because that was the capital of the British rulers, British Empire at that time. And from there they travelled all the way up the Doab, up the Ganges. There are several artists who spent a lot of time in Calcutta, and that is where they, so this is one of the few artists who came to Bombay rather than Calcutta. And the 1 year that he spent in Bombay, he went to Elephanta, he saw the caves of the island of Sashti, and he drew what are the famous 12 views of Bombay at that time. Now these 12 views of Bombay show Bombay in a completely different light as it was in 1791. And you'll find plenty of open spaces. This is a view taken from the Sion Fort, with plenty of open spaces. Now there's one particular thing which I would like to point out in this picture, which might just escape your notice if you have a very cursory look at it, and which is these people standing over here. You see this fat man who is probably the killedar, as we call it, of the fort. It is probably his family, and there's a maid servant carrying a baby here. But look at this chap. He is having a wooden leg and his left arm is missing. So probably a casualty of some war. So we talk a lot about Jaipur foot these days, but here is a man with a wooden foot in this picture. And it's so observantly drawn by James Wales. It gives you an insight of what. And it's a moving picture. Somebody is coming down the steps, he's going forward to receive them. And these small details have been brought out in these pictures. Every picture of those 12 views, you will find some small details that are there in this picture. So these 12 views he made, he also met a lot of English people, British people there, whose families' portraits he drew. And he met a lot of people, and it's a close-knit community. And one of the important people he met there was none other than this man. Now this Sir Charles War Mallet was the British resident at Pune. And he used to come to Bombay off and on, either for change of air or to meet the governor of Bombay to get instructions from him and so on. And in 1790, Charles Mallet had just been awarded the baronetcy, or he had acquired the title of Sir in 1790, because he was instrumental in forging a treaty between the Marathas and the British against Tipu Sultan. And that was his moment of glory, which he wanted to kind of immortalize in a large painting, for which he found that James Wales was the most appropriate instrument. And so he happened to meet James Wales, and he told Wales that rather than spending time in Bombay, why don't you come to Pune? I'm in daily contact with the powers that be in the Maratha Empire at Pune, and I will ask the Peshwa to invite you to Pune. And when you come to Pune, that is going to be your ticket to fame, and that's going to be the way you're going to place where the money lies and where you'll get rewards for the kind of work you're doing. So I think you should come to Pune. Now this man, from this meeting in 1791, was later to have a very close association with Wales. He was to be his patron and later on even his son-in-law. But we'll go to that a little later. So Wales began to find ways to reach Pune. It was not that you just get on the expressway, pay your toll and come here. So he met a man in Bombay who was from Scotland again, from a place called Stirlingshire. And So his name was Hugh Seton. But when he came here, he adopted Eastern dress, he grew a beard, he wore a turban. And this man also went by an alias called Chris Roberts. Now, it's also known that he was an absconder from justice in Scotland, which kind of this disguise and name and all was because of that. And he moved around all over India. Now, this man, Chris Roberts, he gave the route for James Wales in a letter, which route I took when I came from Pune and which route you should take when you come from Bombay. You'll find there are very significant differences in the route that you take today and the route which Wales took at that time. One is he left Bombay from the eastern part, somewhere in the coast, which today the suburb of Bygone lies there. From there he comes by boat to Belapur. He spends the night at Belapur there. Then in the morning he hurries up to Panvel, up the river. And at Panvel there was one place, one Mulla Ali, they call it. Mullan Ali, Mullani Ali, so many type ways the name is spelt, who had a house where all these travelers to Bombay and from Bombay used to stay. So he came there in Panvel, stayed there for the night, and next morning, when all his he got his servants employed over there, who were there for carrying all his luggage, you'll be surprised to hear there were two Parsi gentlemen in this team. One of them was called Dorabji, and this person used to be the key person to get all the stuff that James Wales requires from Bombay. So he used to shuttle between Bombay and Pune. There was a Dorabji, there was a Bowmansi. And both these people were with him throughout when he travelled, and who were kind of making sure he gets the right kind of people to carry his palanquins, to bring his, carry his stuff and kind of supervise over. There was another man called Frank also, three people whom he used to kind of pass on these duties to. So he started from there, came through, it was the month of June, third, fourth week of June, it was raining cats and dogs. And he started from Panvel in that kind of mud, slush, there were no tar roads, knee deep in mud sometimes. So he used to be in the palanquin, four guys carrying him and bringing him across. And he used to say these people are, often they try, pretend as if it's very slow sometimes, very difficult to carry me and I have to get down and walk. And when he reaches Pune, in fact, he says that I walked three-fourths of the distance, the palanquin bearers hardly carried me. So that kind of thing was going on even then, how to avoid your work. And finally, he came from Panvel to Chowk. He mentioned Chowk very specifically, which is even today a point on the highway. And from Chowk, and wherever he finds those small rivulets, rivers, he describes them, that I'm crossing them. Today, they are all named rivers. You can find them. And I've put their names wherever I can. Dams have been built on them, so they become small streams now. And from there, he reaches Khopoli. Now, his first observations at Khopoli is, he sees a magnificent temple there with a huge tank. So if anybody of you go to the old Bombay Pune road where the ghat used to start in the olden days, take a few minutes off, go off the road to the left hand side and have a look at this temple, which was built in 1756 and stands to this date. It was built by the father of Nana Fadnavis. And at that time, this man built a water tank. That water tank is over several acres with a surrounding wall. And that water tank is still supplying water to Khopoli. So he first sees this magnificent temple and this huge tank, and he's highly impressed with the work there. And then he goes to the village of Khopoli and sees the mean, what he calls the mean huts in which people are living. So it kind of is a conflict for him, said that people are making such beautiful temples, so why can't they make their houses as well built? So all these kind of commentary goes on in this journal when he's reaching there. Then after staying at Khopoli, he prefers to stay in his palanquin. He doesn't want to go and stay in the huts. He on the road, he keeps his palanquin, sleeps there. In fact, one incident he describes of having been woken up by buffaloes kind of sniffing next to his palanquin. And he hears loud noises of these animals, cattle all around his place. So these are all highly personal observations, and this guy is very observant. He describes the scenes he sees there. I mean, if you go from Bombay to Pune today by train and see the beautiful green mountains there and the rain waterfalls there, he is describing them all because he's coming up during that time. Then he starts trudging up the ghat. He starts trudging up the ghat and reaches Khandala. And at Khandala, he finds a Maratha chowki where you have to get a passport to proceed any further. He gets the passport. And then instead of coming this way via Talegaon and Malauli, which is this side of Lohgarh, and then this is Talegaon, and then from there you come down to Pune. Instead of doing that, you Seton has given him a route by which he has to go behind the fort of Lohgarh. Now today this route is abandoned because there are two dams which have come up, 100 years back, which was the Bushi Dam, and the second was the dam of Ambegaon, which came after independence. And these two places, Ambegaon village as it stood there, is today buried in that Pavna Dam. And there's a new Ambegaon which is just on the foothills of Lohgarh today. So this road has been abandoned since, but he came by that road. And Ambegaon, he takes a halt. He describes the people there and it's a beautiful village and so on and so forth. Then he crosses the Pavna River after that. He describes the beautiful forts there, Tung, Tikona, Lohgarh. He says these are all Nana Fadnavis' forts. And then he comes to what his diary describes is a place called Dond. D-O-N-D, Dond. I tried my best to find this place on the map, but I couldn't find it with that spelling. Finally, when you really zoom into the maps, you find that there is a place called D-O-N-E, Done, over there. And I drove down till there. It goes beyond Hinjavdi, Marunji. It goes further down there towards Done. And there the road actually ends. And from behind Done, there is a small hill, which is the pass beyond on which this man walked and came to Done, and he spent the night in the temple over there. And after that, he started walking towards what he calls a Wankar, W-A-N-K-E-R. Again, it took me some time to understand what is Wankar, till I realized that the pronunciation of Wakad those days was Wankar. So he comes to Wankar and Wakad, and he comes across the river Mula, which was in flood in those days. And he writes there, the 8 miles from the capital of the Maratha Empire, there are no bridges, there are no boats. How do I reach my destination, which is the bungalow of Sir Charles Mallett on the Sangam, which is where the judge's bungalow is today? So, what he does is better described by an illustration than anything else I can do. This is how he crossed the river Mula. Now, these below are what are called calabashes. they are kind of dried gourds or pumpkins or some such vegetable, which are all tied together in a net. And there are people on the side swimming to steer it across the river. His luggage is piled up on that, and he sits on it with a man with an umbrella. And similarly, such his baggage comes down along with him. And this is how they cross the river Mula. Now, because it is flowing, they embark at one point and they get off somewhere further downstream at another point. But that doesn't seem to disturb this thing in any way. And this mode of crossing rivers was given up in 1793 because it was deemed to be too dangerous. But every messenger who carried a dark from place A to place B in those days carried a calabash with him. And when he had to cross the river, he just strapped it onto his abdomen and crossed the river, floating with that. So, I don't know if this is James Wales, because there is no picture of this man who drew so many pictures. His own picture is not there. And like many other artists, he did not go and make a self-portrait. So, his assistant Robert Mebon has drawn this picture. And probably if he was drawing James Wales, then we would have to conclude that this must have been James Wales. And this is probably the only picture which kind of is a representation of what he looked like at that time. So, this was the situation at that time. And then he reached Charles Mallet's big estate. Now, that estate extended from where the Sangam of the Mula Mutha is today, right up to where the Sangamwadi bridge is. So, that entire College of Engineering area was entirely Charles Mallet's residency. And he reaches there, he is welcomed there. There are many houses there, one of which is allotted to him. There are stables for elephants, camels, horses. A lot of his soldiers also stayed nearby. And of course, where the judge's house today is, was where Mallet himself stayed with his beautiful gardens. Just 4 years before that, one of the Edward Moore, one of the travelers who came to his house, said this is one of the best houses in India, with its gardens and its layout is so beautiful with the river next door that it's an envy of anybody who comes here. Now, the Pune of 1791 or 92 actually, June 1990, 1st of July 1792 is the date he reached Pune. Now, that Pune of that time was a city which had all the principal pillars of the Maratha Empire staying here. There was Sawai Madhavra Peshwa who was staying here. There was Nana Fadnavis who was staying here. And just the previous month, a new person had come, and that was Mahaji Shinde. And Mahaji Shinde came here in 1792, in June of 1792, and he stayed here till he died in early 1794. And so, the day after Wales reached there, the first visitor to reach the residence camp was none other than Mahaji Shinde. And so, he describes the whole episode of how they went forward to receive him 1 mile outside the residency, and elephants and camels and horses, and they brought him back in a procession. And then it also describes that Mahaji Shinde was lame, which we know. When he was coming back from the Battle of Panipat, he had been hit on the back of his knee, and since then he could not walk on his own, and how he had to be supported on both sides and taken to the masnad, and where he sat down. Everybody came and paid respects to him. Sir Charles Mallet went on one knee and presented him some jewels and rose pearls. And his son was next to them. He presented him with some ornaments and so on. So, at that time, they drew several sketches. I mean, there are about six pictures of Mahaji from sketches to available right now with us. So, that entire day with maps of the dancing girls were standing on one side, how much each dancing girl used to make, how much money they used to be earning. So, as you see, it is not just one topic he describes, but whatever he sees around him, he's just mentioning and documenting every one of those points. Should I use this?
I do.
It's changing. Fine. And then right opposite the residency was a beach. Now, if you cross the Sangam pool today from the police headquarters towards the old RTO, you'll find on the left-hand side there's still a beach there. We've got some temples and so on. So, that was the place where, right opposite the judge's bungalow or the residency of those days, is where women were immolating themselves and going sati with their husband's bodies. So, the very second or third day that he was there, he saw one such procession, one such ceremony going on. And he sent his assistant Robert Mebon to draw this sketch. And the notes which are written below the picture are all Wales. He says that actually there were lots of horses and elephants also in this picture, which were not drawn, and they should have been drawn so that they would be more representative. So, here you can find that there's a corpse being washed here in the water, and there's a lady standing somewhere. in the middle, and this is a funeral pyre which is being and if you really zoom into the lens, you'll find in this entire crowd there are men, women, even women bearing children in their arms. So all kinds of people came for this. There used to be trumpets, drums, which were there at that time. And he describes the entire ceremony of how it went on and what kind of things were happening over there. In fact, once he was so horrified by this entire episode that not only this one, he's even drawn sketches over here of what are the positions in which they lay on the funeral pyre. You can see this picture, that the husband's body's corpse is here and the woman is one hand below the neck and the other arm across the body. So he, and here's the funeral pyre burning. So these kind of sketches he keeps drawing. So you know, get a real, he went to see five such things. His assistant also went. Sometimes he used to go on an elephant, so he could see the view from the top to see what kind of things were actually going on. Sometimes he writes that they were all being given some kind of a drug so that they don't feel the pain, and all these things were described, which are really make horrible reading. But as I said, they're some kind of a document of those times which have to be put across, and that is why I have put them. Of course, sati as per se was not as common in Maharashtra as it was in Bengal and Punjab. These were the places where it was much more common. But even here, he saw in his stay there at least five or six instances where this kind of a ceremony was held. Now, when he came to Pune, the first things Wales had to do was to prove himself that he was an artist of merit. Otherwise, he was not going to get commissions from the nobles or the court to draw their pictures. And he didn't have a ready subject. So this man, he was the Persian translator come Vakil of the Bombay government. His name was Nuruddin Hussain Khan. He actually was originally from North India. He was also in the family of Najibuddaula, a character you will see in the forthcoming film Panipat. So he's written his biography also in Persian. So this man finally came down to Cambay, where he was with Mallet, and with Mallet came down to Pune, and he was staying in the residency. So when he came in July, Mallet thought that, Wales thought that, why not make a picture of this person, take it to the court and show how good he is in his work. So this is the man who posed for him for the first painting that he did in Pune. The work went on for nearly 4 weeks. And after 4 weeks, he took that painting on the 8th of August 1792 to the Darbar, showed it to the Peshwa and everybody else. They were extremely impressed by his work. They gave him a shela and they gave him 350 rupees in those days as a prize. And the same evening, you find in his diary, you find a note saying that I have got pictures of Nana Fadnavis and Haripanta Fadke to paint. And this picture he mentions that I wanted to finish it in a highly finished style, and I wanted to make it as a specimen so that the people who want to give him work will be able to see this as a specimen and give him work. So that is why he completed the picture. Now the point is that when I was writing the book, the first thing I had to find was where was this picture, because there were 300 pictures roughly these people had drawn, and this being a highly finished picture and a specimen, all I could get was a black and white picture which was published in two books, one printed in 1921, one printed in 1989. Now there was no way of contacting the authors because both were no more. The publishing house had also wound up, so I got no way of finding out where they got the black and white picture from. And I launched what can best be called as a global search. So anybody of you who might have seen my Twitter account, sometime in August I launched a global search for this picture. And have I gone back? Yeah, I think I can change from here. So and my book was already getting ready by that time, and the deadline for printing to start was 15th of October, and this was in the last week of August that I was putting this up, that if anybody has found this picture, do let me know, and I know that it is not here and not here and so on. So 1 month there was no action, and I had sent this black and white picture to the press that you printed, because I am not getting a color one, and obviously this picture had been lost for more than 100 years. So nobody had ever printed a color version of it. Now, one of the people whom I asked about this picture was a scholar in the Brown University in the US. Her name was Holly Sheffer, and she has been to Pune. So, and she said, I don't know where it is, but I can give you a high resolution image of the black and white picture and so on. Now, sometime in the last week of September, I got a mail from Holly saying, Uday, the picture has emerged. Now that was something which was really a bonus for me, because at least I know the picture is somewhere and it has emerged. And she sent me a link with that. This picture had come up for auction in Bonhams in London. So when I went to the Bonhams website and I looked at it, and the owner of the picture was Princess Alia of Jordan, whose mother had just passed away a few months back. So she had kind of inherited it, and she probably thought it best to auction it in Bonhams, and she put it up for auction. Now I had to either get it from the owner, who was Princess Alia of Jordan, or I had to go to Bonhams, or I had to find somebody who will give me a high resolution print of this picture, because the print on the website was a very low resolution, a few KBs. So I sent out, because the time was short, I sent multiple emails, including to a former retired ambassador, that find somebody in the Jordanian embassy, in Indian embassy there, to contact Princess Alia. Then I asked one person who is to take part in auctions all over the world and buy coins. I said, if you can find somebody in Bonhams, please let me know. The curator of British Library in London, whom I contacted, she said, I'm in the US, I'm coming back on the 4th of October. Another man whom I know in London, who goes to the British Library very often, I said, please go across to Bonhams. He said, I'm in Moscow right now. So all these things were going on. And one email I also sent to Bonhams, which remained unreplied for about 4-5 days. So finally I said that if I have to get this picture, I have to offer something in return. So then I found out there's a specialist named Mr. Oliver White, who was actually dealing with the auction. So I sent him an email at Bonhams saying that this picture, I can give you the provenance of this picture. When was this picture started? When was it completed? Where it went eventually? And what was the response of the Peshwa when it finally reached his Darbar? And so on and so forth. I mean, the auction was on the 22nd of October. I wrote this sometime in 8th or 10th of October. And telling him that, you know, these things can improve the cost of the paintings. That the auction house is more interested in giving as much information to the new prospective buyer as possible. So they said that please send us that note. I got a reply at least that please send us that note, but we have to take permission from the owners. I said fair enough. So next morning I typed out a 2-page note and dashed off the email to Mr. Oliver White, and by evening he had sent me the high resolution picture by email. So you know, I was in business. So I think after all this you deserve to see the picture. Let me see where it is. So, I think this is the best title I can find for it. The picture has emerged, because I mean that was the most exciting email I got when I was writing this book, and I mean I am not going to give you a straight shot straight away. So this is the picture, and here you can't make out the details, but you can see the details in a few moments from now. You can see these things over here, how beautifully they are drawn, and you can see the beard of this man. And you can see the wrinkles around his eyes and so on. Now this picture had a reserve price in Bonhams of 50 to 70,000 pounds, 42 lakhs onwards. And I kept following up what that auction finally yielded, because the book went to print on the 15th of October. But I told him I might make a few changes in the introductory pages, so I can add the amount which it goes for. Sometimes it doesn't get auctioned also, because you know people don't meet the reserve price, it goes back to the owner. So on 22nd of October, it was sold, and I contacted Mr. White and asked him. It was also on the website that it was sold. He said some institution has purchased it, and the final price it was sold at was from 50,000. It was more than five and a half times the amount, 275,000 pounds, or 2.5 crore rupees. So a highly finished, well preserved James Wales painting has, as recently as a month ago, been valued at 2.5 crore rupees, and there are several of them lying around in miserable circumstances. I'll show them to you later on, including some in India also. So this was a very big boost, and I think it's the first time that a color picture of this man has ever been published. Now Nana, of course, was very fond of collecting a lot of works of art. And you know, there are several letters he wrote to his agents in Jaipur, and agents in Delhi, that bring whatever pictures you can back with you. And he used to be very closely associated with James Wales in whatever painting is drawing for him. Like this sketch, of course, is done by Robert Mevon, one of his assistant. Now this painting is today with the descendants of Nana Fadnis, the middle one. And several times James Wales writes that Nana has given me a picture of a lady which he wants me to copy. Now, which lady this is, we don't know. Maybe James Well says maybe it is a household lady. But if you look at her clothes and her appearance, she doesn't appear to be a Hindu lady. So there is a speculation which may be right, may not be wrong. There's no way you can know. Now, Wales never signed his pictures. You won't find anywhere that his picture has been signed as J. Wales. In letters, there are plenty of signatures. But this picture and the size of the picture and looking forward at you, these kind of pictures were drawn not very commonly at that time. And the strokes of this picture appear to be like James Wales. And why would Furness's descendants today have this painting? One conjecture is that Nana Furness had an old painting of an old Muslim courtesan of those days, and people say that it could very well be Mastani. And he wanted, from a smaller miniature, he wanted a bigger painting made. And that's why he finally completed this picture, and that's why they still have it in their family. So we don't know. That is just one of the theories that are floating around. Now, this is a very interesting picture. It is probably of Nana's household gods, the idols of Radha and Krishna, both having a flute. And this painting was never completed, but his pencil sketch is available, which shows where the what are the clothes, the color of the clothes they are wearing, the various rubies and pearls and so on that have been used for making these idols. And then you find Nana commenting on this, that the god should not be quite so muscular. Okay, he must not appear to be more than 15 years of age. The lady must not appear more than 12. They should not be quite so red in their complexion. So these are all notings he tells Wales. So you can see how he's interacting with him when he wants a finished product. So Nana's actually collection of 800 plus miniatures which he had collected during his lifetime have been all deposited. If ever you go to Aurangabad, please try to see it in the Maratha History Museum of Aurangabad. And all those 800 pictures have been digitized there on their computer, but it may not be so easy to cut through the bureaucracy to see them. But you will definitely, if you make an effort, it's worth your while to see the collection which he had at that time. Now, as you go ahead, you find that James will start getting better and better kind of commissions, I would say. One of this I will show you, that what was his process of creating a masterpiece, because there are a lot of component parts in any picture. And like, for example, this diamond studded case which you find over here, this is a betel nut case. And you can see the detailing which you have in this watercolor, which is again done by Robert Mebon, and which was finally put in the main picture. This is the shirpech, which is on the crown of the Peshwa. And it is mentioned, this pearl hanging here and the central diamonds of which color. So you can see the colors here. I think it just got slightly cut off. And then this is the jewel which he wears again on the turban, on the Peshwa's turban. So these kind of smaller component parts were first sketched, and then they were put in the finished painting. So this is the first set of items that he made. Second component, again, this is a Persian sword. Now, in that he writes that this Persian sword was presented to the Peshwa by Mahaji Shinde when he came from the north. Or this rose water jar, which he has. Again, it's studded with various precious stones. Or this man standing as an attendant to the Peshwa. So all these were drawn first before they were finally incorporated into this one of his masterpieces. So that's what called creating a masterpiece. And then the people in that place, the second attendant who was supposed to be with the Peshwa at that time. So he's called a Chori Bardar because he's giving the fly whisk which he has. And then he tries to compose the picture here, where he has one attendant sitting here, two standing behind, one standing in front. Then another composition is with four people behind, two standing behind, and nobody in front. And all these items we just saw placed before the picture. So all these watercolors are shown to the Peshwa and to Nana, and they have to choose which of these is the best arrangement, and then the artist has to choose which is the best arrangement, then he makes the final picture. And after doing all this, he finally goes about and he makes his masterpiece, which is today at the Royal Asiatic Society of Great Britain and Ireland. It's coming, don't worry. Yeah, so this is the picture on the cover of the book. And you can see all these items placed here, these small little items that you see here. They were all this Persian sword and these people standing behind. So all these were finally put together and this final composition was created. So that's how he worked on most of his major paintings that you can see. And this is just one example of that picture. Now this picture does not really give you an idea of how big it is. And it is really big, it's larger than life. Now I can show you the real pictures. When I had gone there a couple of years back, I asked them to take a picture of that painting. And it is larger than life. And you can see we are all sitting in the front, and you can see how big it is. It's probably at least 7 to 7.5 feet high and 5 feet across. Those flashes are all kind of spoiling the view. But this is just to give you an idea of what the size of the painting actually is. Now, in addition to this, in London, there's another painting. Now, why is James Weir not so well known? One reason for that is that all these paintings are lying in like Royal Asiatic Society in London, is not a place which people go to. It is not a museum like Victoria and Albert or something which people just go and see this picture. It's a tucked away in a lane, it's a sleepy kind of a place. It's got opening hours only 4 or 5 days a week. Again, you have to go by appointments and so on and so forth. But that is one reason. The second picture, which is very famous, which is the Darbar picture of Ganesh Mahal in Pune. It is again not on exhibition. Now, this was acquired by the British government in lieu of inheritance tax from the Mallet family. Mallet was the man who wanted that painting to be put because he was the man at the center of it, signing the famous treaty with the Marathas against Tipu Sultan, and for which he got the baronetcy, which is still in this family. So he was the man who was pushing that painting, and after Wales died, the painting was still incomplete. He took it back with him to England, and another famous artist called Thomas Daniel, who was in London. So from his country home, every week you find Mallet going to London and literally supervising how the painting is to be completed. So where's that painting? Yeah. So that painting is today in Tate, Britain. But again, it's not an exhibition, it's in their vaults. And if you want to see it, you have to go through his vaults to see it. So you can see that right at the center of the picture is Charles Mallet. Practically as close as you can get. And they're all standing on one side of the Darbar, which is very unusual because Darbar never is empty on the other side. So this was a composed picture specifically to kind of pander to Mallet's vanity. And then you have all these people, like this is the picture of that Nuruddin Khan, which we saw earlier. Now, Thomas Daniel had never seen Nuruddin Hussain Khan. We just picked up this image from an existing portrait of Wales and put it there. Or, for example, there's a picture here, which is again another Wales painting, which is there in the book. This is of Bhairopanta Mahendre, who was the go-between the Maratha court and the British residency. So again, it's very identical to Wales painting, which again has just been put here. Now, because Thomas Daniel had never come to Pune, this ceiling seems to be very high. None of the Maratha Darbars was so high. And then these pictures were again described to him. These are all the Dashavatar paintings on top, which have been paid here. The idols seem to be all wrong. And so a lot of things are there which are wrong here. But then that's the way Mallet wanted it. So that's why this was made. Now, this again is lying in the vaults of Tate Britain. And it's not easy to see it. You have to take permission by email before you go there, and they are not very forthcoming. If you want to take a photograph, again you have to say, why do you want to take a photograph? You have to justify, oh, I am a researcher, I am an author, you have to give them proof. And this is the size of the actual painting. You see, it's in a box. And then these are all, they have put tapes here so it doesn't fall out of the box. So this is the actual size of the painting. Of course, this is a young man, because it was done several years back when I started taking an interest in James Wales. So that is the painting, again tucked away out of sight, and you can't really see it. Now in Pune itself, there used to be a very highly touched up painting of James Wales. It used to be, I say, because it's no longer on view for at least the last decade or so. Now this painting, it's contested whether Wales actually made it, because it's so different from his other pictures. But the reason for that is that it has been touched up several times. Now the provenance of this painting doesn't leave any doubt in my mind that it belongs to Wales, because this was till 1925, it was in the chambers of the governor of Bombay. And in 1925, there was an exhibition at Pune in the government house, and there is a document which is available today, which says that of the various items shifted from the governor's chamber in Bombay to Pune, one of these was this painting. And since then, it was in the government house, which later on in 1949 became the Pune University building. And since 1949, this was kept there. In the 1870s, this picture was touched up by a Mr. Lewis. Now, I managed to find the name of that man because he's mentioned that he was a brother of the Royal Academician by the same name. Now, all that is written in the plaque which is below that painting. Now, in one of the places, Wales also mentions, now the name of this painting is the Maratha Empire, which is a figure of speech because these were three main pillars of the empire at that time. And it was the year written is 1793 below the painting on the brass plaque. And one of the things which Wales mentions in his diary is when he comes in to Pune after 2 years in 1794, he said, I observe the Peshwa has become fat, fatter than what I saw him last time. So you can see the plump cheeks here in this painting. Of course, by the time 1794 he came, Mahaji was no more. And in fact, all of Mahaji's paintings which he made, the finished paintings were made after Mahaji died in early 1794. So this painting was in Pune University. It's not in sight anymore. All these things are still here, the artifacts which were described. But I don't know what's happened to it because the university has not been very forthcoming about what has happened to the picture. Now, there were several types of entertainment in those days. Now, one picture here shows the entertainment which was offered by Mahaji Shinde. More of a more outgoing kind of a personality. So, this is a tank somewhere 8 miles from the residency. And they used to all go in boats and they call it hawking. Or they used to release a hawk, used to go on the, catch a bird and bring it down. Or sometimes they used to fire at birds which were shot down and so on. So this gives the occupants of various boats who all were sitting there and so on. All the details are mentioned here. So that's on 4th of December 1792. This is one kind of entertainment which people in those days went through. The second entertainment was singing. Country singers used to come from various places, sing before the people there, and they used to get prize, some kind of money in return. Then they used to go for hunting. You can see those trained cheetahs who used to catch hold of deer, and when the man comes to take the cheetah, he used to just release him rather than eating him up himself. They used to be skinned alive that time. So these are both pictures by Robert Mebon, who describes the entertainment of the days. Then one very unusual kind of painting done by James Wales describes a surgical procedure. Now, being a surgeon myself, one normally tends to discount any surgical procedure taking place in India in those days. But here, I mean, this kind of description which he gives over here under the surgery, and including here, this sketch shows all the skin flaps which are taken. Now, this man was a man named Kawasji, and he was a bullock cart driver in the army of Tipu Sultan. For some reason, Tipu Sultan was unhappy with him and he cut off his nose and sent him off from there. And this man landed up in Pune, and in fact there are names of two English surgeons also who were here at that time who went and attended the surgery. There's a man named Kumar who was a surgeon who performed the surgery, and he takes a flap from the forehead, he turns it round using its blood supply and creates a new nose, and the entire procedure is given over here of how that thing is done, how the flaps are taken and how the new nose is composed. So this was known as the Indian method of nose reconstruction, and this was done in the 1790s. Now a picture of this is there in the Welcome collection in London as well as the British Library. Now this method was taken from here to England on the basis of this description of James Wales and this picture. And in 1819, the first nose reconstruction was performed in England based on the Indian method as they called it at that time. So that particular surgery was performed in Pune of all places at that time.
Did the patient survive?
Yeah. This is not a life-threatening procedure. It's just a superficial procedure. Of course, anesthesia was very primitive at those days, so I don't know what they did for that. But otherwise, there's no risk to life during the surgery. This is a picture taken several months later to show that the nose has taken and has been reconstructed. This is not a picture before the nose was cut off, after the nose has been accepted by the body. Yes, this is mentioned here, the surgeons who were present at that time. And even early 19th century British texts describe an Indian method, or they call it the Hindu method, one of those terminologies are used. But for sure, no such procedure was performed in Britain before early 19th century. But because here cutting off nose was a very common punishment, they had to find an answer. And that's how it probably, you know, necessity is the mother of invention. That's how it probably came up here. Now, from here we move on to antiquities. Now, one of the things which Wales was very passionate about and which would not necessarily earn him money straight away was the antiquities and excavations of India, which was the caves of India. From Elephanta to Kaneri, he was the second European to go to Ellora, the first being his patron Charles Mallet. And he took along two or three artists along with him, a large team, and he went there in 1795 when there's a war going on between the Nizam and the Marathas. And he starts off, when he's going back from Pune to Bombay, he stops at Ekvira in December. You can see the date here, 20th December 1792, on the road from Pune to Bombay. And he spends a few hours in Karla Caves. And he makes this quick sketch in his journal, taking the measurements, 130 feet long, 50 feet high, this ceiling of the porch, 60 feet high. These three things you see are the elephants you see in the porch at Karla on both sides. Then it takes a circumference of what those days was called a Mahadev's Ling. Because Buddhism had disappeared for so long in India, that all the Buddhist caves were thought as Brahminical caves. And all the stupas were considered as Mahadev's Ling. So all his descriptions, when you find, whether it's Ellora, Karla or so on, the stupa is described as Mahadev's Shivaling. Again, he describes it 130 feet high, 60 feet circumference. So these are the first archaeological drawings of the caves of India. Before this, the man who had done the earliest drawing was Colin Mackenzie, who, as Dr. Pradhan mentioned the other day, drew them of the Amaravati caves in Andhra Pradesh, and that date was 1796. Now here you have a record that this was done in 1792, which suddenly puts him as the first person to make drawings of the caves of India. Actually, this drawing was what set me off on writing this book. Because Dr. Pradhan had once come to me, saw this picture and said that this has to be published. And so I kept aside the other book I was doing and I came back to this. Then he goes about measuring various caves, measuring, drawing their plans and painting. So you have the everything, you have the plan, you have the, like you see here, four caves. This first one is the Karla caves, Ekvira. This is the Jogeshwari caves, this is the Pataleshwar caves, and this is the Kondivte or the Mahakali caves. So he's drawn plans of all these. Then he goes and makes paintings of various ones. This is the painting of Elephanta which he has done. And he measures all of them. So this is exceptional observations and drawings which are left behind and which had to be presented to especially people who are interested in this kind of field. Elephanta, of course, Wales went several times. And this elephant is now in the Bahudaji Lad Museum in the Jizamata Udyan, just outside there. It's kept there now. But that is what gave the island the name, Elephanta. Otherwise, it's called Gharapuri, or actually a derivation from Grihapuri. And Puri was the old capital of one of the old empires of that part. And this is Elephanta looking from the Trimurti or the Sadashiv outwards. This is the picture which is drawn. Now, another very strange thing is mentioned about Elephanta, which today I don't know whether it can be verified. I'm sure people in archaeology will be able to mention this, because you can't possibly climb on top of the three faces there and see what's behind it. But he mentions there is a hollow behind it, behind that that triple head, as he calls it. And he even climbs up to see it. So because the idea of this picture of Sadashiva is that there are four or probably even a fifth face on top. It's a Panchamukhi Shivalinga, or at least a Chaturmukhi Shivalinga. So in which case there has to be a place behind for the fourth, whether you sculpt it or not. He said there is a hollow behind it. So I would leave that to the archaeology department to really go into the details of this. But he has mentioned it in his diary for sure. Then he goes to Ellora and spends 6 weeks there. And right from the point he sees the first view, he says, why is this is the original Grishneshwar temple? Because the Krishna means to chisel. And the present Jyotirlinga of Grishneshwar, which is right next to this, is called Grishneshwar because it was from chiseling. And this was the original Grishneshwar temple, which was Kailas. Now these are the two temples, the two caves at Ellora, which are there. He's probably drawn about 20-30 views, which are part of the Thomas Daniel 144 engravings, one section, part 6, belongs to James Wales. And those were completed and engraved by Thomas Daniel. And there's an exhibition going on even today in the Red Fort, curated by Giles Stillitz, and who's written a foreword to my book. So those, if anybody happens to go to Delhi, do go to the Red Fort. There's a one-year-long exhibition of, out of one section belongs to James Wales. Of course, Buddhism was not known that time. So even this was considered to be a, Vishwakarma was a Buddhist stupa, but still was called to be a Brahminical cave at that time. Then you come to Bombay and he goes to Sashti at Salset, and there he discovers these six what he calls obelisks. Actually they are veergars or hero stones showing the exploits of heroes who have taken part in battles long past. Some of them are even naval battles with multiple sails and multiple oars, you can see over here. So showing that there was a seafaring country and even those days. And these were next to a pond about a mile away from Kaneri at that time. Now obviously they have been shifted from there, and today you find them near a place called Exar. They are next to a huge apartment block, and today they are probably kind of revered as some kind of a goddess. So this is one of them. You can see the original he has drawn, and same kalash on top, same picture. So he documented these, very carefully documented all the obelisks. And he also went to Kaneri, Jogeshwari, Mandapeshwar and so on. Now, Mandapeshwar again he documents that this was a cave which was converted by the Portuguese into a chapel, and then the murtis there were kind of broken down to portray a cross and so on, and he describes all that in his book. And in 1795 when he goes from Ellora back to Mumbai, Bombay, he went back because his wife was expecting a baby. And he goes back in the month of May, and unfortunately his wife, who had come here 1.5 years after him, dies in childbirth. And the entire monsoon he spends in Bombay, and then after monsoon in the month of October he goes back to Sashti, and he goes around seeing all the caves there, which is Jogeshwari and Kaneri and so on, and describes them in great detail. And that time he goes by boat. At Warsaw he gets onto a ship called Princess Amelia, which is captained by one George Millet, Captain George Millet. And George Millet, while Wales writes his own notes about Kaneri, you find another 20-page note by George Millet, who describes, in fact, in even greater detail what Wales is doing in Kaneri and what kind of caves he finds there and so on. And from Kaneri, they go from Warsaw by sea and they go to Ghodbandar, which is the northern tip of Salset Island. Now, today, if you want to go to Kaneri caves, you go to Borivali and walk eastwards or drive eastwards. Those days the route to come to Kaneri was from Ghodbandar, and you come across from the north southwards to reach Kaneri. So that's how they came. And after finishing Kaneri he went to Mandapeshwar, and then he came to Jogeshwari, which he calls Amboli, because Amboli is a village nearby that place. And there, because Jogeshwari was a place which was not very, the first thing it's subterranean, water is to collect there for large parts of the year, the rock was all eaten up and so on. And there a lot of people fall sick with fever and headache and so on and so forth. And that is where Wales also gets contract some kind of a fever. Now the irony of it is that just the time when Wales is acquiring this fever, in Pune, his most famous subject, Sawai Madhavra Peshwa, sustains a fall from his terrace over here, and he breaks his thigh bone, and he multiple fractures on the face, loss of a lot of teeth, and 3 days later the Peshwa dies. And here James Wales falls sick in Jogeshwari, and Captain Millet describes his illness and so on. Because Millet takes him to his house in Bombay, and over there Captain Millet has in his own diary mentioned the last days of James Wales, who dies just 2 weeks after the Peshwa. And he says that my worthy intelligent friend Mr. Wales unhappily fell a victim to the putrid air we inhaled at the caves in an unhealthy season of the year. With him I fear we will lost some valuable information, which is investigating turn of mind and very able talents, with the aid and under the patronage of the enlightened Sir Charles Mallett, would have enabled him to add to the correct drawings and measurements he was about to publish of these monuments of early genius and human labour. Mr. Wales died in my house at Bombay. Now there is a lot of conjecture where he died. Did he die at Kaneri? Did he die at Thane? He very specifically mentioned he died in my house at Bombay. exceedingly lamented and left a family of 5 orphan girls, actually he had 3 orphan girls that time, without fortune and under the protection of many friends whose humane dispositions, warm almost as their meridian sun, will I trust succor these children of affliction, raise them to future happiness and prosperity. Now Wales left 3 daughters behind. Now the youngest child, who was an infant, died the month after Wales died, and 2 daughters were left behind. Now these 2 daughters were, Charles Mallet became their guardian. And Charles Mallet already had a wife here, a Rajput lady, who's got a beautiful painting. I mean, that is in the book. That painting is a very beautiful looking woman with several ornaments on her, and it's one of his masterpieces. Now he had 3 children with her, and in 1798, when he quit as the resident here and went back to England, he left a Bibi Amber Kaur in India, well provided for, it is mentioned, and with his Wales 2 daughters went back to England, and then they lived with his mother. And in 1800, it is mentioned that he renounced his guardianship of Susan, who was the elder daughter of James Wales, and married her. And then he lived with her for another 15 years. He died in 1815. He had 8 children with her over there. Even, in fact, Susan Wales is supposed to have called her 3 children over here again to England. And Susan Wales, of course, lived till about 89 years of age. She was there for a very long time. So that was how abruptly the story of James Wales ends. And you can imagine the voluminous documentation he must have collected that time, which he could not complete, could not publish. There are a lot of mentions about a prospectus for publishing, so and so, the subscriptions which I will get, how much will each book cost, what book, who will pay for how much, what should be the size of this thing, that this should be printed in England. So all this thing was going on when he suddenly died, and that was the end of the story. You can see from this picture in the end that it was believed quite seriously. You can see a Brahmin priest telling his devotees to pray before this stupa of Ekvira or Karla. And this was until then believed to be a stupa of Mahadev. So there is a lot more, I think, in the book, which I can't cover in the time given to me. But I hope that I was able to at least impart some of the things that are given in the book. Thanks a lot, Khushru.